Good morning. My name is Cheryl Vogel. I'm a member relations manager for NTCA. I hope you had a great first day at the conference and are ready for a great day two. I hope everyone is enjoying their time here in San Francisco. For our first breakout session, don't click on that, Cyber Lessons for the Pros. Get ready to hear about the latest cyber scams and security issues that are affecting all of us. Please welcome Gary Berman, CEO of Cyberman Security.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you, everybody. I really appreciate that. Let me begin by asking you by round of applause, how many of you have ever been hacked? Just round of applause. For those of you who did not applaud, the probabilities are that you are already compromised. I didn't want to start with that, but it is, you know, generally kind of true. And the reason that's generally really true is because the criminals and threat actors are unbelievably sophisticated. And they're very, very competent. They understand, you know, human behavior, you know, very, very well. And so our mission today, during our time together, is to share with you some of the tactics and techniques and the ways that criminals and threat actors use technology to do nefarious kinds of things. And so before we do that, I just want to ask by round of applause, how many of you like Marvel Comics? Round of applause. Okay. The reason I ask that is you see this character in a cape, and I wonder if you might be thinking, why would a 65-year-old man wear a cape? So I'm going to share with you a little bit about my origin story from being a victim of cybercrime to becoming an advocate. My mission is to shine the light on the unsung cyber heroes who toil in anonymity to keep us safe at work and at home and at school. So after my company and I were compromised, we ended up having to close it and ultimately laid off all of our people. I said, okay, I have to learn about cybercrime. So where do you start? I mean, I had no idea, so I went to something called the SANS Institute. And this is a training company that teaches people about cybersecurity. And I went to the conference, and I asked if I could please just sit in for 15 minutes just to get a sense of, is this something my brain, you know, could understand? And in 10 minutes, I left, because it was too complicated. So I bought a book called Cybersecurity for Dummies. Have any of you ever used the dummy series? Just round of applause so I can tell. For different kinds of things, yeah. So I thought, okay, great. Cybersecurity for Dummies, it seems like a good place to start. 10 pages into that book, I was lost. So rather than quitting, since I decided I was going to be on a mission to try to help other people, I found the company that wrote it and the author, you know, who did it, and I told him that story, and he busts out just laughing, you know, and I'm a funny guy, having sort of lost, you know, everything, but I was still laughing rather than, you know, alternatives. And so I said, may I ask why you're laughing so hard? And he paused and he goes, well, it's not really for beginners. Then why do you call it Cybersecurity for Dummies? So I figured there had to be a better way to distill complicated technology information in a way that people could get their heads around it, at least a little bit. And so I started listening to podcasts. I started giving speeches about this. I went to 54 cybersecurity conferences in 4 years. My wife thought, and probably still thinks, that I'm a little bit nuts for doing so. But I was on a mission, and so I started learning. This is me with the former Secretary of Homeland security, and I started working out on weightlifting machines called Cybex, on the idea that maybe if I physically got myself a little bit stronger, somehow that would help me. It did not work, by the way. And so over time, eventually, I did pick up a few things about this. This was, you know, many years ago. And so I started working on a superhero comic series called The Adventures of Cyberman. And the only problem with that is I had no idea what I was talking about, what I would put in there, and I was terrible at drawing. And other than that, I was kind of, I guess, perfect for the mission. So I went to the source of comics. Stan Lee, you may he rest in peace, was one of the creators of Marvel Comics. And I started realizing there are certain commonalities in the way that superheroes are depicted. You know, they're larger, they lean forward, they are action-oriented and things like that. So this is the comic series that we developed. It's called The Cyberhero Adventures, Defenders of the Digital Universe. And it became a thing in the technology ecosystem around the world because it turns out many people who are in technology or in cybersecurity also love comics and things like that. So that's the journey of how I got to this moment. And so the reason that I'm here, and I really want to thank Dennis and the NTCA for having me. It's a privilege for being back again to talk with you about why does this matter at all? And you know, the big idea to take away from this particular information is it's the same thing as the physical world. You know, one would not leave a car unlocked in a parking lot that was not well lit and then leave it for the night with valuables like a purse inside your front seat. That's just, you know, common sense. So the principles, you know, that we're going to be talking to you about and a lot of the specifics are really based on that idea that cybersecurity essentially is the same as physical security. So just some quick terms, a bad actor, a hacker, cyber attack. Bad actor is anyone who wants to do you harm. And there are many criminals who want to do people harm. Not to try to be scary about it, it's just true. And they might want to steal, you know, your identity or, you know, steal your credit card information or have a romance scam for an elderly mom, you know, to take advantage of their goodness and things like that. And they'll do it for financial gain. Sometimes they do it just because they can, which is one of the interesting things about motivations of threat actors, of hackers, you know, is that, you know, making a very general statement, many of them, as they were coming up or growing up, were socially somewhat awkward. And as, you know, brilliant as they are in the technology space, we're correspondingly lacking some things like empathy. So they don't really care who you are for the most part. They care what they can get from you, like your money, like your identity, and things like that. So just to give you some idea, 5.2 billion internet users, and these numbers are just skyrocketing because of new technologies providing internet around the world. But over 60% of the population of the world have access to the internet. And so my mission, you know, for you right now, my wish for you right now is to begin to think about how to take a few steps that are going to make you and your business and your families more secure while online. Let me be crystal clear. I'm a huge proponent of technology and of the internet. It does unbelievably great things. Many of you have a cell phone in your pocket that has more compute power than all of the space missions that we've ever launched. It's in your pocket. You know, and with it comes a certain awareness and opportunity to keep yourself and the people, you know, whom you love safe. So basically, cybercrime falls into these three areas of theft, fraud, and sometimes even murder, but I'll go into that. That's really pretty rare. But cyber defense basics can be incredibly valuable. You know, one of the interesting things about this mission is that you don't have to do many things to get big results to keep yourself and your organization safe. It's always a bunch of small things that I'm going to be sharing with you that you can take away and start implementing right away on your phones. I'll just start with one right now. Turn off your location services in your phone. Go to settings and just disable it unless you're planning on using it. That really significantly reduces threat actors or criminals' opportunity to track you by the phone. So that's something you can do during the break if you want. So these are some of the examples, identity theft, pornography, financial, intellectual property violations, malware, which stands for malicious, a code that a threat actor or criminal would want to insert on your devices without you knowing it. And malware, it's really anything that's intended to do damage, because oftentimes by damaging you just as society or the world, they profit from it. And it's relatively easy for them to do. So examples of malware, as you see here, are ransomware, which is when they shut off your access to all of your information until you pay them money to give you a key to open it up again. And I was doing some work recently with some small, medium business owners, and someone said, I don't really have anything that anybody would be interested in, which, I've heard, many times, and that's a very understandable statement, until you cannot access it. Then all of a sudden, if you're a small dentist office or a law firm or an accounting firm, you realize, oh my goodness, I forgot that I use my technology in this way and I really need it back. So ransomware has other very, very significant downsides to it. For example, recently in the last 2 months, the Los Angeles area school system was hacked and held for ransom. So if you think about that for a moment, what does that do, for children and their ability to be educated, especially in this time of hybrid learning and things like that? So it can have, very, very deleterious effects on real people. But there are things that you can do to protect yourself, which, again, I'm going to show you a little bit. So the names that you see on the left here are real versions or strains of malicious ware. And a lot of them are attached to what are called bots. And bots are a short-term name for kind of robots, which are rampant all over the internet. Many of them are actually very good and very helpful. So when you go to do a Google search about something, a lot of this is automated and very helpful to allow you to find the information that you are seeking to accomplish. So bots by themselves are not inherently bad. However, the threat actors and criminals use these automated systems to attack, far and wide, and to attack with incredible speed and velocity. This could be, hundreds of thousands of computers affected or infected even at the same time. And that's one of the things that the autonomous nature of bots do. And so the malicious ones, gosh, they can gather your passwords. They can record everything you type, right? I mean, think about that for a minute. They can record everything that you type, and they see it in what's called clear text. In other words, they can just see what you're typing, on your machine. And so if you're, logging into your bank or a small business or a rural telecom, you know, operation, or a manufacturing facility, or things like that, they can actually, you know, record what's happening. They can get, you know, financial information, which is incredibly valuable, you know, to an organization and to people individually as well. They can hijack social media accounts, which is can be incredibly, you know, dangerous. This has happened with TikTok. And by round of applause, how many of you here use TikTok? Anybody? Not too many here. You know, as you know for sure, for the younger generation, TikTok is very, very popular. It's a short form of videos. It can be, you know, about anything. And there are billions of people who use it all around the whole world. And the thing about that from a cybersecurity perspective is the data all goes through servers in China, even though they say that it doesn't. So there are currently negotiations going on between the US government pertaining to national security and TikTok to find a way to see if they can come to some compromise to ensure that your information, anybody's information on the platform remains in the United States. Now, again, you know, just to let you know about the implications of something like that, I was briefed by someone relating to the national security about TikTok, and he said to me something that really was just quite sobering, which is, imagine if we, God forbid, get into a kinetic war with China, and China has the information and can control information flow through their TikTok. They can do misinformation or disinformation and things like that. Imagine for a second if we needed to recruit young people into the US military, and if the primary source of the information that they're getting is from this platform, that at least to some degree, the information is under the control of an adversary, it'd be very easy to see, you know, how problematic something like that, you know, could be for the US government. And for citizens around the world. So I'm gonna pause for just a moment and just let you know this is the scary part, you know, that I just shared with you. And I have to tell you firsthand, you know, I was very scared about all this until I realized that there are superpowers that are available to people. So I'm gonna just show you a little bit about mine. I don't know if you can see it. Round of applause if you can see that. Can you? Yeah. I have good news for you. My actual costume is kind of made of spandex, but you do not wanna see this body in a spandex suit, so that's why I wore this this shirt. But you know, to make a very long story short, there are things you can do to protect yourself. So, for example, regarding some kind of physical cyber attack, this is something that happens incredibly often, especially to small businesses, because people are designed to trust. Our strength as humanity is also our weakness, which is the desire to trust and to be part of a larger group. And the criminals know that, and so they take advantage of that in terms of not just online, but also in a physical sense. So, you know, anything that is connected to the internet, anything, can be hacked. So if you think of, how many of you by round of applause have some type of a webcam at home, like a Ring doorbell or something like that? Round of applause so I can get some idea. So maybe about 20% or so. So each of these cameras, to varying degrees, I don't really want to point out anyone specific, but generally are not super secure. And the reason is they have to make it easy for people to use it. So there's this inherent kind of a conflict between being safe online and someone's ease of using what it is that they're wanting to get done. And that's in my world called, you know, friction. When you have a user having to go through multiple steps in order to stay safe, you know, while online. And just for a moment, the term user is very interesting. I always thought it was probably not a good term, but in our industry, we use the term users to account for the number of people who are on a particular platform or things, you know, of that nature. The only other use of that word in common conversations is actually deals with substance abuse. Like, oh, that person's, you know, a user. And it has very negative and scary connotations, you know, unfortunately, for people who go through that. You know, and in our industry, we call them users. And I was reflecting on that recently. You know, and if you think about the amount of time that we spend on our devices and how in some generations across the age spectrum, we spend more time doing that than we do in actual conversations with our loved ones. You know, there are some addiction kind of challenges using technology, you know, whether it be a cell phone or being on a screen or things like that. And I just found out recently that I'm going to be a grandfather to a baby girl. So a round of applause for my unborn child. So thank you. And the reason I mention that is, you know, how old should a child be before they get access to some sort of screen? You know, it's a very interesting question, because on one hand, it's great. They'll have the world at their fingertips, given the controls that the parents place on the device. On the other hand, what does it mean to be a human? What does it mean to be able to, you know, look someone in the eyes and understand what they're saying to you without saying it? And so it's a very interesting series of evolutions that are now happening very, very quickly. And that's one of the big challenges pertaining to technology and cybersecurity. It's the pace of change. It's just happening so fast. How many of you have an iPhone? Just a round of applause so I can tell. Oh, that's a majority. Thank you for doing that. It's a majority of you have an iPhone. So they just came out with an iPhone 14. They just announced it. However, if you reflect on all the capabilities of, let's say, an iPhone 10, like four generations ago, while it's true they do a few different things, most of us don't even use the capabilities that an old phone has. But they're such great marketers that they understand how to create, you know, demand and get us excited about the newest and latest, you know, technology, when maybe there's not really that big of a difference between the versions that you had earlier. The reason I mentioned that is because from a cybersecurity perspective, they're doing a much better job of keeping you safe. So one of the things you want to stay safe from is social engineering. And this is when I was mentioning earlier, they take advantage of your goodness as humans. Our desire to be part of something larger than ourselves is a long-term thing. Oh, sorry, this is going ahead here. The desire to be, you know, part of a larger group is incredibly important and ingrained in us. And so there are all types of examples of social engineering, like phishing. So phishing is misspelled on purpose, but it's a very appropriate way to describe a certain type of malware that you want to be careful of, which is why the title of my talk is Don't Click on That Link, because the link is the number one way that criminals trick you and social engineer you into downloading their software and then becoming, unintentionally a victim. But they also do things by talking to you. Have any of you ever gotten a phone call about customer support for your technology? Just a round of applause. Anyone ever gotten an unsolicited call? So, a handful. That's what they do. You know, they'll pretend to be a legitimate, person from a big vendor like Microsoft or something like that, and to, try to convince you that you need to download this link or this file or this photograph. And in doing so, without our knowledge, they're downloading malware, which gives them control over our technology. Now, the reason that I think that you want to care about this, and I'm so grateful that you're with us today, is because of privacy. I'm not sure there is privacy online. Not too much. And the reason is, one of them, is because when we sign on for a platform, Facebook or Twitter or whatever the technology is that you're using, we click the little accept terms button without reading it. Very few of us, including myself, ever really read the terms of the agreement that we're signing up to, because they're long and they're complicated and they're hard to understand. So this whole notion of phishing, as I was mentioning, is a way that cyber criminals want to take control over your stuff. And there are actually three different types of phishing, just so you know. One is called spray and pray, which is like a fishing rod. So criminals will send out millions and millions of these fake emails and things like that. Another one is called spear phishing, which is when you target an actual regular person. That's in part what happened in my case. And then a third one is called whale phishing, which is like a harpoon. And that's when you're going for CEOs or owners of small to medium businesses. And these are criminal activities that are widely known and used in the underworld to take advantage of all of us. So these are some examples. You can get an email or a text message or a phone call, something in social media, and also suspicious hyperlinks. So, the number one piece of advice that I can give you for when you leave our time together today is, please don't click on links. Just try not to do it, even as tempting as it is, even if it looks like it's going to be coming from someone that you know. And there are different ways to be able to check to make sure it's okay by going directly to the website that it comes from. So many of you might have seen or experienced fake notifications from banks, like you need to validate this transfer when you didn't actually make it, or things along those lines. So you have to be very, very aware. Don't click on links if you can at all avoid it. If you have to click on it because it's from a trusted colleague or a family member, you can copy the link and then paste it into another tab in your URL. That's one of the tools that you can use to make it a little bit better to see what it is. And in the long string of numbers and information that you see inside the white space of a browser, sometimes you can actually see things that are wrong. Like you see the name of your bank misspelled by one letter. Now this is not easy to do. It takes a kind of hyper vigilance about it, and it does take more time to do so, but it is a great way to avoid being phished. So this is an email. Just take a moment to look at it carefully, and while you're doing that, what I'm going to do is ask you if you would click on this, or you think it's a legitimate email from a trusted advisor. And there is quite a bit of information in an email. That's the interesting thing about that technology. It's very dense. There can be a lot of information in a single email. And so what you always check first is who is it from. So in this particular case, you see there's a hyphen in between the word legitimate and looking, and another hyphen in between the word looking and source. That's a clue that this could be a problematic email. You can also see that if I read this out, a vulnerability has been identified in big name software that allows an attacker to record calls and videos from your computer without your knowledge. That's all fine. Please install the attacked update. So there's a typo. That would be attached update rather than attacked update by the end of the day. We have also created app, so there's, you're missing an. It would say, it should say, we have also created an app. We've also created an app for all employees to determine if they've been, so you see the word have is missing. It should say if they have been affected by this vulnerability. And then it says click here. You never want to just click on anything like that with what's called the hyperlink. That's what I was saying earlier. If you feel compelled to look into it, open it up in a different browser, and no matter what, don't give any personal information like your credit card or anything confidential that they are trying to get from you. So this is a legitimate, what's called spoofed email. And we use the word spoofed to describe that it looks legitimate. And if you're sitting there working, especially now that many people are working from home on their home computers, you just see an email, you go, oh, okay, that's from John or from Susie. And it's very tempting and easy to click on it. So please be careful about doing that. This is alluded to the earlier kind of statement about murder. This is a legitimate thing that does happen, unfortunately, and it happens quite a bit amongst people who play video games. And people in the video gaming industry are highly competitive. There are monetary prizes. You know, there's attention and accolades from people from all over the world. So they're very competitive. And so this is something that occasionally happens where someone who's either playing a video game or someone who wants to do damage to the person actually calls law enforcement saying that, oh my gosh, you know, there's been a threat, you know, a bomb threat, or someone is breaking into our door and things like that. And so this is an incredibly serious matter for, you know, law enforcement, because they have to respond, you know, and this is something that unfortunately, you know, does happen and is kind of part of this world. These are some other avenues of attack. As I mentioned earlier, everything connected to the internet most likely can be hacked. And there's a really kind of basic reason that is the case, which is it's expensive to make small devices or Internet of Thing devices like a webcam at home or a refrigerator, or even your automobile, the fobs opening, closing, you know, cars and things like that. It's incredibly difficult and challenging to make them cybersecurity, make them secure and also affordable to people. So there's a price trade-off for this and for the manufacturers who make, you know, all these devices, which, I know there are billions and billions of Internet of Things devices connected right now. I don't want to misspeak the actual number, but it's tens of billions, and it is projected to grow full speed, like a hockey stick. So how can you better protect yourself, you know, while you're online? Something like a wireless router, if you log into, you know, any hotel and there's free internet or you pay for it, unfortunately, it's not secure. That's a wide open way to access the internet, like at a coffee shop or on an airplane. And one of the tools that you can protect yourself with is called a virtual private network, or VPN. Another takeaway from our time today is if you have not had the opportunity to install something like that, please do so. There are many of them, they're called virtual private networks or VPNs, that basically obfuscate the IP address coming from your computer. And that makes you a whole degree safer and anonymous if you're gonna use an unsecure network. And it's incredibly tempting to do so. I mean, I did. I needed to, check my internet, and I have a couple different ways of protecting my stuff. But just by doing something like a VPN, which costs maybe $5 a month, something like that. So it's not expensive, and it's super easy to download. If you have a few minutes, if you have never done it, super easy to use. And the thing about criminals is, basically they're going to go for the easiest targets. And so by just having, that layer of protection, it may be just enough to keep you safe. They'll just move on to someone else. You want to always make sure that your software is up to date. Many systems, you have a button that you can click, or your tech, people can help you with to just enable automatic updates. And that's super important. Every month, the big companies, or at least Microsoft, has something called Patch Tuesday. And they release all these patches for vulnerabilities and things in their own software. And it's free to keep your systems up to date, and it's a great idea to do that. Multi-factor authentication is incredibly important. And basically what that means is that in addition to a username and password, before being able to gain access to your systems, you have another code that is sent by text to your phone, which is a lot better than nothing, but not that great. Or you might get a phone call from an automated system to put in a code. And so multi-factor authentication is a huge way to keep yourself safe online. And you could use a password manager also, which makes complicated and long passwords and things like that easy to deal with. I'm going to talk more about that in just a minute. You have an amazing opportunity with an NTCA and a program that you have called CyberShare. It's a small broadband provider for the Information Sharing and Analysis Center. When it comes to information, like the things that I'm sharing with you, a rising tide lifts all ships. So I would encourage you to look into CyberShare. There's a desk right outside so that you'll get the benefit of people who can help protect you. And it's a very nominal fee from what I understand, and that's another for sure thing that I would do as soon as we're done. As we're wrapping up here, talking about password tips, use different passwords on different systems and accounts, and I know that's a pain. It is. It's just hard to remember passwords, and it's a pain, but do the best you can. Use the longest passwords that are allowed, because the number one password year after year after year is 123456 7. The second most common one is the word password around the world. It was something like 20% of all passwords are that. So just take a few minutes on your mobile device that you have on you, or in your technology at home, to use, create long passwords, because the longer the passwords are, the harder it is for criminals to decode them. Use a mix of upper and lowercase numbers and symbols. Reset your password every few months, which is difficult to do because we all have so many different accounts and so many different passwords. So that's why, as I was mentioning a little bit earlier, you'd want to use a password manager. That's another big takeaway from our time together. You can use a password manager. You can get a VPN. Make sure that you don't click on links. Make sure you are careful about opening up the emails you know, that that you're using. And so as I'm just kind of wrapping up here for a moment, I want to thank you for taking the time to listen and learn a little bit about how to stay safe online and why the title of my talk with you today is Don't Click on That. Because the simplest things give you the most protection. And this is especially true, I think, for your industry because you're in rural broadband and the information that you have is increasingly valuable to criminals because of all the money that's flowing in to this ecosystem to facilitate, you know, additional broadband in the United States. So there's quite a bit of interest in your industry from some of the bad folks. But you should know that there are way more defenders than there are criminals. And there's a lot of reason to be optimistic, but to be aware. So on behalf of a grateful digital universe, thank you so much for who you are and what you do and why you do it. And feel free to connect with me on LinkedIn. I also host a show called the Cyber Hero Adventure Show. I interview the most important people in cybersecurity all around the world about a wide range of things. I'm going to be traveling to Saudi Arabia in 2 weeks for a technology conference. Then I'll be keynoting the oil and natural gas ISAC meeting that's coming up because this all matters. Protecting our nation has national security information, and you start, national security implications rather, and it really starts with each one of us. So I hope in some small way that you can benefit from the experiences that I went through and that you feel a little bit more enlightened and empowered to stay safe while you and your families are online. So thank you so much. Thank you.